because today is a very important topic Rahul Jain is going to take, because I think every specialist and every general practitioner should know what all kind of poisonings are around here. And you need to see to it that, you know, how to manage them. So I think we hand over a very important topic to Rahul Jain, and I'm sure he is going to do a great job, as he has been doing so far. Rahul Jain.
So today we discussed toxicology and drugs. So is the screen visible?
Yes. No, screen is not visible.
This is coming, the word written. Is coming. Good morning, everyone. Today, let's discuss toxicology and drugs. And myself, Dr. Rahul Jain, and these lectures are happening under the guidance of Dr. Sharda Jain. Without much further ado, let's start today, discuss toxicology and drugs. We'll be taking the topic in the brief, and over the whole the presentation, we'll be going first. Then, for any toxicology or any poisoning case, how to follow the case, how to diagnose the case, what is the common treatment for all the poisoning, what are the principles, and also in the end we will just discuss the common poisonings which we see today in PD and in our emergency departments. So first, what are the principles of treatment? We'll just understand that when we are treating a patient of poisoning or any patient suffering from overdose of any drug, what are our goals of the treatment? So first goal is obviously supporting the vital signs. Any patient, we need to maintain the vitals. The four vitals which are most important are blood pressure, pulse, temperature, and respiratory rate or saturation. So we have to maintain these four vitals. So the first step in supporting the vital sign is to maintain the homeostasis. So homeostasis refers to maintaining the normal physiology of the person as close as possible. Then along treating with the actual poisoning, I need to prevent the secondary complications. So each and every complication is relevant. So suppose if I'm talking about any patient who has taken something by mouth or something like that, then I need to make sure that he's not going for aspiration pneumonia or end pneumonia, which is due to the retention of secretion. So when I've admitted and under critical care ICUs, I need to make sure that patient is undergoing chest physiotherapy. Then going over to cerebral edema, then any CNS poisons can cause cerebral edema. Then bed sores, because they'll be lying down the whole day in the critical care. Then arrhythmia, the poison can affect any electrolyte disbalance. Then DVT, so I need to start them on heparins, anticoagulants and all. Then again, renal failure, hypoxia and coagulopathy can occur, and infections are very common. So the first treatment, the first principle of treatment is supporting the vital sign. So the moment we have to follow the same thing, the same dictum while treating the patient of toxicology. Second is, so it is very simple. If a person consumes the toxins or comes in contact with the toxin or takes it deliberately from the motive of suicide, we have to stop the further absorption of toxin, or if it is already present in the blood, we need to remove it. So the first principle was supporting the vital sign, and the next two principles will be, first of all, stopping the absorption of the drug if it is not absorbed till now. So suppose we know that someone has taken a drug just 2 hours back, and I know he has taken tablets, so I know it is still present in the stomach, which is not completely absorbed. So the first treatment is to terminate the more exposure. So I need to stop that exposure. So I need to do something so that the drug which is already present in the stomach should come out. And then the next step will be to increase the elimination of the body. So okay, we'll discuss them. So now, how do I reduce the absorption of toxin? To know that, I need to know that how the toxin has gone inside. So if it was an inhalational toxin, so suppose I say a person of carbon monoxide poisoning. So whenever we talk about toxicology, history becomes very, very important, because there are thousands of toxins, and to pinpoint a toxin, it's only the history which can give me the clue, or a specific exposure. Patient will commonly patients family members will bring a bottle that he has pill, he or she has consumed this specific pill. But suppose in case of carbon monoxide poisoning, they will give history that there was an angiti on inside the room with coal burning, and it's winter, then they locked their rooms and they were sleeping. And when they found them, they were not responding or something like that. So I know at that time, it should give me a hint that it is carbon monoxide poisoning. So history is very important. So first is inhalational exposure. So inhalational exposure means the exposure is through lungs. So at that time, to reduce the absorption, I need to start them on oxygen, high flow oxygen. Then if the exposure was dermal, which means the poison was somehow entered the body through skin, then I need to change the patient's clothes and I need to shower the patient, clean the whole body with water and sponging. So OP poisoning is very common through dermal exposure. OP poisoning refers to organophosphates. Again, a very common poisoning we see nowadays. Then eye exposure. So if some chemical has gone inside the eye or it has the exposure is through eye, then I need to just keep irrigating the eye through plenty of saline so that I terminate the exposure there. And coming to the most important one, the oral exposure. If someone has taken any pill and all, then I need to terminate the exposure through those, or I need to remove the drug from the system. Then either I go for vomiting, gastric lavage, activated charcoal and whole bowel irrigation. So I think vomiting, the concept is very simple, that whenever the person will vomit, whatever is there in upper GI tract will come out, and there is exposure termination, the exposure will get terminated. Coming to gastric lavage, again the concept is very simple, that I will remove whatever is there in stomach, I will repeatedly remove it. So again the exposure will get terminated if the drug is present in the stomach. Coming to activated charcoal. So activated charcoal has a very interesting phenomena. This charcoal will bind to whatever is present in the GI tract and will not let it get absorbed. It will get passed in the stools. And whole bowel irrigation again to clean the whole GI tract. So this explains something. And vomiting. So forced emesis. So I need to tell the patient to vomit and to ask the patient to vomit. The best actually is the saline water. I take a glass of water, I add a lot of salt and I ask the person to drink. The moment he'll drink that salty water, he'll vomit the whole thing out. And then we have syrup of ipecac available. The second thing is gastric lavage. So how this gastric lavage is done, nasogastric tube is put in the picture also, we can see. And then I will put some fluid through this nasogastric tube, and this fluid will go inside the stomach, and then I'll remove the whole thing, and then I'll keep repeating the procedure. So what is most important is to know in this gastric lavage is when not to do it. So we need to know why not to do it, because our intervention can be more deadly than the poison. Correct. So first is coma patients. So if a patient is not awake, we cannot do this procedure. The reason is very simple. The moment patient goes in coma, or the GCS, the Glasgow Coma Scale, goes below 8, the any person we are putting this tube and all, we are making the person prone for aspiration pneumonia. And aspiration pneumonia is very deadly. So basically, for aspiration pneumonia, what happens that anything through with coming from a stomach or anything goes inside the lungs, it gets aspirated into the respiratory tract, it goes to the lungs and it causes chemical pneumonitis, and then it gets very hard to manage the patient. So aspiration pneumonia, we need to avoid the aspiration pneumonia. And then for corrosive poisoning, any corrosives, if someone is taking acid poisoning, alcohol, someone has drank acid directly, then also we do not perform gastric lavage or even emesis, because there is a risk of aspiration pneumonia. And kerosene poisoning also, because even kerosene poisoning, if kerosene accidentally, the fumes are also inhaled inside the respiratory tract, then also it can cause multiple problems, and intestinal perforation also it can cause, esophageal perforation, because it will thin out the esophagus during the exposure, and the moment we put a nasogastric tube, it becomes very thin and we can break it. So and last is activated charcoal. So again, also it is given by NG tube in the dose of 12.5 grams per hourly. The total dose is 50 to 100 grams. And if it's a foreign body, we can just remove it by endoscopic removal. So I hope the concept of reduction of absorption of toxin is very clear. So we need to identify where is the entry of point where the toxin has entered the body. If it is respiratory tract, give oxygen. If it is dermal, you need to wash the skin. If it is eye, continuous irrigation. If it was oral, then clean the GI tract through multiple methods which we have discussed. Vomiting, gastric lavage, charcoal. So the first history becomes where, how the person has been poisoned. Then the most important principle, third principle is whatever is now present inside the body, I need to enhance its elimination. So, but the important thing is we have two compartments in our body, intracellular fluid and extracellular fluid. So if a drug which is more common and goes towards the intracellular fluid, I cannot apply this principle of enhancing the poison elimination because it is already inside the intracellular fluid and there's no way I can replace the intracellular fluid. But as far as if a drug is only limited to or majorly distributed to extracellular fluid, I can apply this principle and I can change this drug because my mainly extracellular fluid constitutes of plasma and my blood products. But talking about intracellular, it is the volume which is inside the cell. So if a drug is majorly distributed to extracellular fluid compartment, then only I can apply this principle of enhancing the poison elimination. So how is it that I need to know the drug is acidic or alkaline? So suppose if a drug is acidic and I turn the urine of the patient alkaline, so that alkaline and acidic will react and it will start getting excreted in the urine. So I will start the patient on drugs which will make the urine of the patient alkaline. So again, I need to know what drug. So history again becomes very important because I can only treat the patient. There is a guided treatment for everything and I can only treat the patient if I know what is the toxin which he associated. And the last is hemodialysis, which is always the best, but has its own indication that we need to dialyze the patient if we think the kidney is not able to excrete the toxin out. And also to save the kidney if the toxin is immunotoxin. I hope the poison elimination announcement is very clear. Then how to approach the patient of toxicology. So any toxin patient, we have this dictum which we always follow. We will discuss that how to remember this dictum also. So first is always ABC. Any patient coming to emergency, we follow ABC. So what is ABC? Is airway. So the dictum is why airway first and then circulation, because what kills first should be treated first. So airway is first important is we have to maintain the airway of the patient. So how will we maintain, how will we check for the airway? We will see the patient's gag reflex is normal or not. If his coughing reflex is normal or not, we have to keep the position of the patient. We have to keep the patient in a position that the airway remains patent. Or if any secretions in the upper respiratory tract, then I need to clear them out. So this is the first step. Coming toxicology patient coming to ED emergency department, then I need to see that the gag reflex or cough reflex is intact or not. It's getting sucked or not the secretions. And if required, if the GCS is going below 8, then I need to intubate the patient. Then going over to breathing. So in respect to breathing, I need to take an ABG sample of the patient because many of the toxins maybe can be acids or can be alkalis are associated with acid-base balance, disbalance, electrolyte disbalance. So I need to check the acid-base gas analysis and also to treat the targeted therapy. It might be that the patient is getting some massive electrolyte imbalance or something like acid-base imbalance, and if we don't treat it or didn't take care of it immediately, then it might be fatal for the patient. So acid-base gas analysis is very important in case of toxicology. And then for oxygen support, we need to start the oxygen support if SpO2 is less than 90% at any time, and bag and mask ventilation again if SpO2 is less than 90%. Then coming to circulation, so what is important in circulation is my blood pressure measurement, my pulse, obtaining the IV line, doing the ECG, routine blood investigation, and altered mental status. First, in circulation, the five things are important. So all my vitals, ECG, obtaining the IV line, starting the patient of fluids, and routine blood investigations. We will discuss each and every word and how to remember them. So, but now, as of now, let's focus on why are we doing it. So I think airway and breathing are very clear, and they are taken care of first. Then moving on to circulation, it is BP, pulse, obtaining the IV line, ECG. So we need to check BP and pulse. So we should be sure that patient is not going in any kind of hypotension, tachycardia, and any arrhythmia. And accordingly, we need to take care of them. Obtaining the IV line, because all our interventions from now from there on will be given through IV line methods. So it should not be like now I have to give some treatment, I'll be searching for IV line. The moment a patient enters ED, I should be establishing IV line so that I can administer the treatment as rapid as possible. Then I need to do ECG for any arrhythmias, and many poisonings are associated with hypoglycemia. We should always remember there are very few poisonings which are associated with hypoglycemia, and one which is very commonly seen is acute alcohol intoxication.
Okay.
So any patient of alcohol intoxication, I need to make sure that he is not going towards hypoglycemia. And if the patient is going towards hypoglycemia, I need to treat it. Then for rectal temperature, for any because it is the most accurate temperature, which can be measured, and then seizures control. If patient is undergoing any seizure, if patient is having seizures, then I need to control them, because every seizure is debilitating to the brain of the patient. So if I am not able to establish an IV line due to ongoing seizure, rectal diazepam is a good choice. Can be administered easily also.
Okay.
Then
how much is the dose?
For rectal diazepam, I think about 20 mg.
You should be very sure what how much is again.
Okay. And then agitation control. I need to control agitated patient. And then coming to the diagnosis of the poisoning. So as I already discussed, history is very important. History is very important because it will help us to pinpoint what is the diagnosis of poisoning, which poisoning it is associated with. Then any allergies. So we need to ask that if the patient is being allergic to anything. If we give any treatment and the patient is allergic to it, that might confuse us with physical symptoms. Then physical examination. So I need to do a brief examination that which system the toxin is mainly involving, if it is already there in the system. So I need to know if, suppose it is a snake bite, then it can be hemotoxic poison, it can be neurotoxic poison. So there I just need to know that it will give us more clue that what poison it was. So physical examination, or if I can see purpura over the whole body, small red spots, that I know that it is affecting platelets or some coagulation abnormality, then I know it's hemotoxic. Then again, analyzing that ABJ report and electrolyte correction is the first thing and most important, because we have discussed in previous videos also that any kind of potassium disturbance or sodium disturbance can cause a lot of trouble. So sodium disturbances can cause seizures, and potassium disturbances can cause heart problems, arrhythmias and all that can be fatal to the patient. So electrolyte correction is important before I start the treatment of toxins. Then associated renal failure. So for this electrolyte correction associated renal failure and tox screen, I have already sent the investigation where I was as the patient entered. So when we see we are doing airway breathing circulation, they are all three done simultaneously. So when the patient is being sent, initially only we have sent for basic investigation. So CBC, KFT, serum electrolytes. So by the time we have come to the diagnosis, within 45 minutes, our reports are in our hand. So ABG report we have, electrolyte report we have, and if there is associated renal failure. So why are we sending this investigation the beginning only? We need to target our patients' therapies based on the important things. So when I do GRBS here,
what
I
is
know
GRBS?
That if there is any hypoglycemia, glucose, random blood sugar. Random blood sugar. So I need to know the random blood sugar at that moment. If I do GRBS and I get to know this hypoglycemia, I can treat it right away. I do KFT, I get to know serum creatinine and my status of my kidneys. If I do serum electrolytes, I get to know electrolyte imbalance, and before step only I've done ABG. So when I do these three and I get immediately reports. So suppose I am detecting a patient who is in severe kidney failure. I cannot eliminate the poison from the body. I need to put the patient immediately on hemodialysis. So I need to do these three investigations in the beginning itself. Then we have something called a tox screen or toxicology screen, where we send randomly, if we are not sure what toxin, then we just send randomly the urine sample and blood sample, and then they screen them for most common poisons. So yes, coming to next subject, ABG. In ABG, there is something called metabolic acidosis. So when we discuss about metabolic acidosis is also of two types. Basically, we have four main acid-base disorders, which consists of respiratory alkalosis, respiratory acidosis, metabolic acidosis, and metabolic alkalosis. Under metabolic acidosis, I have again two types, high anion gap and low anion gap. So what is important is there are many toxins which causes high anion gap metabolic acidosis. So ABG reports comes in 10 minutes. And suppose I'm deficient in history, then and I see high anion gap metabolic acidosis, then I know that I have a very small list only to rule out. So the mnemonic to remember it is the easiest in mud piles. So mud piles. So it's methanol for M, U for uremia, D for diabetic ketoacidosis. So even my diabetic ketoacidosis, which we have discussed in complication of diabetes, and even alcoholic ketosis, so this can also cause my high anion gap metabolic acidosis. Then P is for paracetamol poisoning. I is for isoniazid poisoning. L is for lactic acidosis. E is very important. So E, because we see glycol poisoning, ethanol poisoning, and methanol poisoning, all three will show high anion gap metabolic acidosis. And the last is salicylate. So all my aspirin, NSAIDs, my acetyl salicylic acid can cause. In this mud piles, what is important is that there are some drugs which are very commonly used. So one is paracetamol, one is glycol, one is ethanol, one is methanol. So all these drugs and even salicylates, aspirin, they are very commonly used. So what is commonly available, people tend to abuse it, or there are more incidences of toxicology associated with it. So just one example. So today morphine is not available openly. So we don't see morphine poisoning so much. Because what is not available, people cannot abuse it. Yes, and even it's the same thing with alcohol. Alcohol is legal and it's available. So we will see incidents of alcohol poisoning a lot. So we need to remember that drugs which are commonly available over the counter. So paracetamol over the counter is available. So ethylene glycol, ethanol, then methanol. So all these things will cause high anion gap metabolic acidosis. So mud piles is one important thing. Then yes, when I have diagnosed the poison, again going to the principles of treatment only. So first is decontamination. So we have already discussed this, washing of skin in organophosphorus poisoning patient, because I need to terminate the exposure. And then if it's inhalational exposure, give oxygen support. If it is GI exposure, activated charcoal, gastric lavage, whole bowel irrigation. What is important in gastric lavage and even vomiting is when not to do it. So we have discussed three conditions where we are not any comatose patient or decreased consciousness patient. Then kerosene poisoning patient, and the third is any corrosive poisoning. So we need to remember these three points, very important. So never to do these gastric lavage or induction of vomiting in these three patients. So because our treatment will be more hazardous to the patient than the toxic itself. Then again, enhanced in our elimination, we have discussed this hemodialysis and yes, and alkalinization of urine also is part of it. Then before we, if the patient, if the toxin exposure was minor, and we are able to take care of the whole toxin problem in the ED department only, emergency department, then one more important thing is psychiatric consultation. So mainly the patient is commonly the patient is suicidal when we see a history of toxicology. So maybe some fight has happened or something, or maybe there's some relationship issue. So we need to call for a psychiatric consultation and admit them under the psychiatry ward, so that the patient does not harm herself or himself later in the future. So because whatever the therapy we have given to the patient and whatever we have done for the patient, it won't be worth it if the patient is not treated and he repeats it next day.
Correct.
So psychiatric consultation is very important if we suspect any foul play or any suicide. Then I always remember it with a very simple mnemonic, which is ABCDEFGH. So A is airway, breathe, breathing. C is circulation. D is diazepam or even decontamination. E is electrolytes check. F is fluids. G is glucose. And H is hyperthermia or pyrexia temperature. So any patient, or if we suspect anything and we are confused at what next to do, remember this ABCDEFGH. It covers majorly important things. So it covers obviously airway, breathing, circulation, which are very important. So then it covers my seizure prophylaxis, so diazepam. Then it covers my electrolytes. Electrolytes again are very important. So if I need to know that there is any potassium or sodium disturbance, I need to know about fluid status. So the patient is dehydrated, they can go immediately into renal failure and all. I need to know glucose status. So any hypoglycemia, even hyperglycemia, diabetic ketoacidosis are varied presentation, even hypoglycemia is a varied presentation. So I need to know these things. Then any temperature control. So paracetamol is preferred. So ABCDEFGH, very simple. If we go by this dictum, then yes, we'll not miss emergency conditions. Then yes. So this much only about the basic toxicology and approach, and then how to treat and the patient. So other approach are identifying the specific poison and treating accordingly for it. So next topic will go on.
Rahul here. I think, you know, this is first part of presentation. So we will write down toxicology one.
Yes,
ma'am. Now we will go on to those. So you have summarized it very well. That these mnemonics are really going to work. एक mnemonics है कि इसका क्या cause है poisoning का, और दूसरा चीज है आपका कैसा treatment है. I think things are very simple. A is for airway, B is for breathing, C is for circulation, D is for drugs, E for electrolytes, F is for fluid, G is for glucose, and H is for no pyrexia. So I think you know वही आपके cause हो गए और आपने वही आपने principle है treatment में लगाया गया. ठीक है.
Yes,
so now we go to the phase two.
Yes,
again you introduce yourself, come on your face and then